Grace, mercy, and peace to you all. In the name of God, our Father, and our Lord, and the Spirit of Jesus. Amen. If you join me in a word of prayer. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we thank you for these words that you lay before us this morning. Lord, we thank you that you encourage us to deal differently with people, with each other. Lord, not just with each other, but with others around, people who are not of this tribe, people who are not of this faith. Lord, you encourage us to deal differently. And we ask, Lord, that we be able to do so, that we be able to listen, we be able to follow through your power, through your spirit in us, in your name, Jesus. Amen. So we are doing this theme for this year called Who is My Neighbor? And it's from Luke. Way back in Luke, there's a man who desires to be justified in response to some stuff that's going on with Jesus, and he asks Jesus this question, who is my neighbor? In response to that, Jesus tells the story of the Good Samaritan and how this one was a neighbor by showing mercy. And so we've been kind of picking up various strands of this, and the strand that I wanted to kind of pick up today was the neighbor that I'd rather not have. I don't know if any of you have ever had a neighbor you'd rather not have. I've had at least two. I was actually looking, it's kind of starting off the little so far. There's a couple of neighbors that I have just absolutely, utterly, like my literal, actual, physical neighbors, just not wanted to be my neighbor at all anymore. One of them, when Lynn and I got married, we lived out in Mankato. We lived in an apartment because that's where we were at in life. And if you've ever lived in an apartment, you know that apartment living is its own special kind of specialness. You pack a whole bunch of people into this place. Anyway, this guy, we were on the second floor, and he was on the third floor. And he, at just the most random times, would just crank his radio. And like, it had a nice subwoofer, and the bass was just... And it's like 2 a.m, and like, you know? And maybe some of you have children, maybe they've done that to you as well. But this guy, he was just like super inconsiderate, right? Like this was a problem. So, you know, you get the broom, and you're smacking it at your ceiling, and you're like doing all that, and one time I did that and he came down and was very drunk and angry with me for smacking the broom at the ceiling. And I was like, but do you not know what you're doing? Another neighbor that I had when I was a kid, we had these neighbors who lived next to us. We lived out in Lake Elmo, and we had these neighbors who lived next to us, and they were just kind of, well, they were just jerky. And they were just, you know, I don't even know how to describe these people, but they had this Doberman. They had a Doberman, and they taught the dog to be mean, right? There were these people that enjoyed teaching animals to be mean. And so this Doberman at one point bit my brother, Danny, on his butt, which was good, I suppose, instead of other places. Could have bit him other places. But this was not good neighbors. They just were not. Good, have you had these neighbors? Have you had them? Because this is who God is talking about when he talks to Jonah. The Assyrian people in Nineveh, this is Assyria, the capital of Assyria, the Assyrian Empire. Like, they're the people who teach their Dobermans to bite people. They're the people who turn on their stereo full blast at 2 a.m. They are inconsiderate, they are aggressive, they don't care who you are or what you think or anything. And God tells Jonah that he's supposed to go to Nineveh, their capital, and bring with him this message that exists from God. And Jonah says, no, I don't want to. We're going to find out why he says that in just a second, but a little bit more into the context. Nineveh, so Jonah's here in Jerusalem. We'll say this, it's Jerusalem. And Joppa's like pretty close, it's about 20 And Nineveh's like right here. Like, it's like right over here. It's not far. Actually, if you follow the news for the last 10 years or so, if you've ever heard of the city of Mosul in Iraq, you've probably seen this in the news at some point. Mosul is pretty much where Nineveh was. So you've got that. So Jonah's here. And Jonah's here. He says, I could go over here to this place, to Nineveh, or I could go to probably Sicily or Spain, which is like the opposite direction, like all the way over here, right? The scholars have like various disagreements on where exactly Tarshish was, but it's somewhere to the west. So it's pretty much trying to go as far as he can in the opposite direction from doing the thing that God wants him to do. Because the Assyrians, the Ninevites, are bad. I don't want them to be my neighbor. And Jonah, you'll find out later, Jonah says to God, isn't this what I was talking to you about back in Jerusalem? God, I feared that you might be merciful to these people. And I didn't want you to be. I mean, if you look at the actual message that Jonah goes and he proclaims, as soon as he gets there, there's a little fish in the middle that I cut out so that we didn't read all of Jonah. He gets into the city, and his message is, repent, or 40 days you'll be destroyed. And that's his message. He doesn't like be like, you know, Jesus loves you, everyone. No, he says, repent, right? And this was the act of love that he was fleeing from giving to these people. He was fleeing from calling them to repentance. He's fleeing from this, but it was still that this was love. He really had no love in his heart for these people. He wanted them to be destroyed. He wanted their end. And he knew God could bring that about. He knew it. He also knew that God was gracious and merciful, and God might have mercy on them, and they don't deserve it. They are utterly the guy with the stereo, the neighbors with the dog. They don't deserve mercy. Jonah has a system, and Jonah understands this system pretty well. And you and I, we have a system, we have a code, right? Somebody messes with you, you don't take it. I was doing chapel at CLS this week. We were talking about the gospel reading. I said, how many of you, if I came up and I slapped you, you would slap me back? And almost every kid raised their hand. They know the code. And I'm like, guys, I'm a lot bigger than you. Like, I could probably smack you a whole lot more hard. But Jonah has a system. The Assyrians, these people were inconsiderate. They were aggressive. They don't deserve God. They don't deserve mercy. They don't deserve anything except for destruction. Jonah's system is that he's got like a one strike on them. You know, whether we come up with like a three strike system and you're out, then and, you know, we've got other systems. Fool me once, shame on me. Fool me twice. No, fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, shame on you. I'm about to George Bush it. Like, oh man. Oh, it's going to be bad. It's going to be recorded. And you're like, what? Yeah. We've got systems. We've got codes. We've got, how do we deal with people? How are we going to deal with people? How are we going to deal with a neighbor that I'd rather not have? Right? What kind of passive-aggressive thing will I do in order to help them not be my neighbor anymore? It's most dangerous for us as the people of God when we think that we know better than God, when we follow some code that is not the code of God. And so we have this temptation to flee. We have this temptation to try to find whatever great distance is available for us. If God is calling us to a neighbor over here, we say, "Oh, I'm going to go over here." We have a temptation to walk away, to follow our own path. This is Jonah. This is us. It's not new. It's very old. And Jesus says, no. No. When it comes to these people who you'd rather not be your neighbor, when it comes, I mean, how much worse can it be? Well, you know, here are the people who persecute you. Here are the people who are literally your enemy. Here are these people. And Jesus says, no, no eye for eye with them. No tooth for tooth. No. That will not be my people. My people will be something else. You will not engage in the system of Jonah where you run away. Oh, but Lord, don't you understand? These people are inconsiderate and aggressive. These people deserve your judgment and wrath. And Jesus says, yeah, sure, absolutely, but it is my judgment and my wrath, not yours. Let me be the one who is either judging or merciful. Your job is to be merciful. And he says yes. Because it's not just no to us that we just take it, right? It's not just, you know, here are these people, you know, they're inconsiderate, they're aggressive, they're coming at. No, he doesn't just say no. He says, yes, I want you to love them. I want you to actively engage in the ways and things that are loving of these people that you would rather not have as your neighbor. I don't know about you. I know it's easier not to for me. I know it's easier to give into the particular temptation of running away. I know that it is far easier to hate those who hate me, to return evil for evil. You might be better at this than I am, but I know me, and I know that is easier. But I also know that I have a calling, and I know that you have a calling, and I know that we have a calling. And I know that calling is simply this, to love them. To love them. It's the only thing, you see, that changes anyone. Evil for evil does not change us. It just makes us hate more. That's how it works. That's why it's a temptation, because it doesn't come to us from God. It comes to us from Satan. Evil for evil does not change us for the better. It changes us only for the worse. Sometimes that love has to come in calling for repentance from others. Sometimes it has to simply come in humble submission. But it must always come in the form of love. It must always come in the form of concern and care for the neighbor. Even, and perhaps especially, Jesus teaches, for the one that we'd rather not have. And as it does, we disarm the powers of oppression, injustice, hatred, anger, fear. All of those things lose their teeth when we stop resisting Satan. Do unto me, Lord. I mean, Jesus has this. He goes to be crucified. He goes to die. He does this willingly. And in his willingness to go do this, he disarms the power of death. It's gone. Who is my neighbor? Well, it's, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. Right? He's being persecuted. He's being, Father, forgive them. Love these neighbors. You have them, I'm sure. Maybe they're not your literal neighbors. Maybe they are your literal neighbors. But there are certain people who exist within your realm who are people that you would rather not have as your neighbor. They're out there. They exist. Love them. Love them. That's the call of our realm for us today and forever. And maybe there's no fruit that comes from it. And we certainly want to make sure that there is some fruit. But we know that God uses these actions. We've seen that God uses these actions to bring about repentance, to bring about His mercy. And we get to rejoice that this is the God that we worship. And in His name, amen. I invite you to stand. We join in professing our faith using the words of the